What's up, y'all? Welcome back to another episode of Next Gen Podcast. It's your boy, Destiny, a.k.a. Griffith Kid, and I'm here with...
Myla, how are you?
I'm doing good, Myla. Thank you for coming through for the show for one time. Great. And for those of you at home, man, today's topic is this generation.
As a whole, yeah.
That's pretty rolled, yes.
Okay, great.
Do you want to start off?
All right, so I think... this generation is very spur of the moment. We don't like to be committed to too many things at once. And I think that kind of goes into like our issue with like success. Like we want instant success instead of working for it. So I think that's what we struggle with sometimes.
Okay. And, you know, it's funny that you say that too, because that's something I wanted too, you know, over time. I was like, man, I want this now, you know, and I realized, man, if I did get it now, I may have not, like, appreciated, you know, the work that I put into it
as opposed to now,
you know?
Yeah, I mean, I'm like that. Like, you can ask anybody. Like, I hate waiting in lines. I hate waiting, period. Like, I want things instantly. Yeah. And usually I get it just because I'm blessed.
Right.
But some situations I end up getting very discouraged because not everything's going to work out for me. Right. In every situation, I keep forgetting that. So...
That's true. So when things don't work out for you, how you handle it?
I definitely pout, and I have like a little tantrum, you know, because like, why doesn't things work out for me? Like, that doesn't make sense to me, because like everything usually works out for me. So like when it doesn't, I have like a tantrum, and I start calling my mom and seeing what she can do, who she knows. So
I see. Like for me, I'm not gonna hold you. When things don't work out for me, I don't get frustrated as much anymore. Really? I suppose maybe I was like 18 or 19, you know?
Yeah.
I'm just been like, you know, it is what it is, you know, and try to figure out, okay, what can I do? You know, what's another alternative, you know, and go from there.
Yeah.
You know? And you mentioned that, you know, I don't know if you ever had this class, but like this a therapy session, or you know,
yeah,
you have. Okay, and I have this is a subject that we had to talk about in therapy, and you know, me, I've never really been the type of person to, you know, to do therapy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not saying that it's bad or anything like
yeah,
that, but
I
it's
get
just
it.
Something that I never, you know, considered. But as we were, you know, doing this assignment, you know, one of our classes, we did some research and that's how that, you know, it could be, you know, very helpful. Like, there's different types of, you know, therapy. What's your take on it?
Therapy, I mean, I have a therapist right now. I've kind of like ghosted her. I just have issues with people telling me what to do sometimes. Because I feel like therapy, it works out in some instances. And I think sometimes, like, just me being a hard headed person, I'm like, why are you telling, like, I know better than you. Like, I'm living my life so I can do what I think is best. So, like, I just stopped talking to her. But I'm going to talk to her again later.
Okay. But do you feel like you've, in the sessions that you have, become at least improved or better than you were the day before?
Sometimes I feel like if she's very stern and like kind of aggressive, I'll listen and I'll feel like a little better just because I'm kind of like forced to do something and forced to make a difference. But other times I feel like it's just a waste of time.
I see. And when I was reading this book, it said that there's a certain ways a therapist should, you know, talk to their client upon the culture and I know that even my accent is your therapist.
Yes, she is black.
Okay. You know, I didn't want to jump into.
Yeah, but she's not like, she's very like put together, so she doesn't really let that side show too much.
Okay.
I think probably out of like professionalism and probably like being cautious, but I think that's what I respond best to.
Right.
So like when she does it, like when she becomes like very like precious with her words and very like babyish, I'm like, why are you talking to me? So.
Okay. I see. And you know, everyone has their own definition of therapy. You know, mine is going to the gym.
Really?
Yeah, because it helps me focus. Mm-hmm. You know, even when, you know, if I'm upset, then, you know, I'm like, you know, I go to, you know, go to the gym, mm-hmm. do a workout. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And I listen to this motivational speaker called Eric Thomas, or E.T., the hip hop preacher. I don't know. Yeah. Have you heard of him?
I think so.
Okay, yeah. Well, he's my role model.
Really? That's great.
He is, yeah. That person is my pops. You know what I'm saying? That's because, you know, of what he's, you know, the man he's become. You know, I'm trying to become like him, just, you know, better. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, that's what every, you know, parent wants.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, so, like, whenever I'm in the gym, I would listen to Eric Thomas, and, you know, he helped me, you know, focus on, like, okay, this is the goal I want. These are some of the things that I might have to sacrifice to get it, and, you know, going from there. And once I'm done, you know, with the workout, man, I feel better. I feel calm. I feel relaxed. I feel like, okay, I'm ready for it. That's the world has, you know, for me. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, you know, my other method for therapy is also music, too. I like listening to music when I'm doing my assignments. Depending on what the assignment is, well, I'm not gonna lie. What the assignment is, I listen to, you know, Young Dolph, man. I know who you don't know. You all know. You know who he is?
Yes, I know.
Oh, okay.
He is.
Yeah, it's Dolph. Okay. I had to. Shout out to Dolph, man.
Right.
I listen to Dolph. My brother Uzi, not Lil Uzi. There's another Uzi.
Oh,
man.
Okay, another Uzi.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. He's a rapper, you know, a Christian rapper.
Okay, that's great.
Yeah. And he's a, you know, good friend of mine. And I listen to him and 50 Cent.
50 Cent.
Yeah, they don't judge me, man.
I'm not judging you. I listened to 50 Cent this morning.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah. What's your you got? I feel like your first show is Candy Shop.
I like Hate It or Love It. You know that song?
What?
By the Hell Game and 50 Cent. I love that song.
It's really 50 Cent.
It's like a story.
You know what I'm saying? But it is. It's, but my favorite one, surprisingly, is I Whoop Your Head, man.
Oh, Lord.
I'm sorry, but, man, once I heard that song, I'm like, hey, yo, I need this.
That's a good song.
It is. And it's actually in the 50 Cent movie.
I've never watched that movie.
You never watched Give It a Die Try?
No.
Oh, okay. I'll put you on.
Okay, bet.
But anyway, man, yeah, so, you know, the gym and going to listen to music is my two, you know, things of versions of therapy.
Yeah.
And go for, like, a cool walk, you know, with my girl.
Yeah, I agree.
Like, what's your, you know, obviously, you know, you do therapy, but do you, like, let's say, like, maybe your therapist cancels, or do you have, like,
she don't cancel. I always cancel.
Okay.
Because sometimes I just don't feel like talking. So what I like to do, I like to go shopping. Retail therapy is a real thing. Retail therapy is a real thing.
For those who don't know, could you?
Retail therapy means going out and buying stuff. Just buying, spending money. That's a real thing. It makes me feel in control.
Right.
And like that I can have the world. Like, and I kind of went overboard. Definitely used the credit card. Definitely went into my savings accounts. But I did feel better afterward. And it's mostly stuff to like make me feel more confident. So it won't be like little like junk and stuff. It'll be like getting my nails done or something.
Okay.
Yeah,
who?
My nails.
Oh, my bad. Okay.
buying a new wig. I don't know. Stuff like that. Just like because if you feel good, like if you look good, you feel good.
Okay, true.
At least for me. Another thing I do, like I'll go on drives. Like I drive around campus sometimes.
Right.
Just like take that lap.
Yeah.
And listen to music with my window down. Like I've always done that ever since I got my car.
Right.
Window down, music bumping, and I'd be feeling great.
Who you be listening to?
Anything and everything. I listen.
White capping.
I go through Fleetwood Mac. You know what Fleetwood Mac is?
No.
Okay then. Okay then.
You know what?
Fleetwood Mac. I listen to The Girl in Red. I listen to Pink Panthers. Ice Spice. Nicki Minaj.
You would listen to Ice Spice.
Is that supposed to be an offensive thing?
No, I just said.
Oh, okay. That's a compliment.
Yes, of course.
Thank you. I'll listen to anything. If it's good, it's good.
Even country?
A country?
Yeah, country music.
Hell no.
You just said you listen to it. How you going?
The only country song I listen to, there's two. It's Tennessee Whiskey and Came Here to Forget by Blake Shelton. Every other country song, it sounds the same to me, unfortunately.
Okay. What about Afrobeats? Like Nigerian music?
Like Tyler?
No. Like Davido, Wizkid.
Nah. I listen to Tyler. Tyler is Afrobeats.
Tyler who?
Tyler
who?
Make me sweat.
Oh. I think you're talking about Tyler the Creator.
No, I listen to him too.
I guess. You know, okay. So, chopping and getting us down, go for a drive. So, that's her.
Yeah, those are my two.
Go-to's, okay.
Or going out. I go out to, like, events on campus.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. And, you know, your friends, you know, do they also, like, you know, help you out, you know?
Yeah, I felt like really stuck in my bed, and my friends like keep inviting me to stuff, like knocking on my door, telling me to get up. So like sometimes you need that person, like that's in person, that's willing to help you out of like that slump and like forcefully do it out of love.
Okay.
So they'll like tell me like, okay, let's go to this party, let's go to this event on campus, or let's go get something to eat just to get me out of bed, because sometimes like your bed can be your worst enemy.
Right. True. Yeah. Okay. Is working out also like, you know, a therapy?
I used to work out. I tried that again and I never felt worse. Like, I was so sore. Like, I couldn't even walk.
Oh, that's good. That was you doing it right.
I was sore for like 2 days.
Yeah. I mean, if you haven't been in the gym, then maybe you're going to be sore.
I'm probably not going back. I used to work out all the time. Yeah. Now is I'm too far gone.
Oh well, I won't say that. I'll just say that you're just taking a little break.
No, I took a year break.
Exactly. That's why your ass is sore. Yeah, it's definitely understandable, you know.
Yeah.
But like I said, I'm in the gym. You know, the one thing I like about the gym, personally for me, it's like a safe place for everybody.
I cannot agree.
Okay, can I explain what I mean though?
Yeah, you go ahead.
I mean, in a sense where, like, you could be the best, you could be the person that's the most in shape, and you could have another person that's, like, not even in shape. Mm-hmm. But we all come in the same place. We're all trying to get that certain type of body.
I see what I'm saying?
And the girls, you know what I'm saying? There could be a baddie on the left and, you know, a little cool girl on the right.
That's
But hold on, though. It don't matter because it's all a safe place.
It's not a safe place for women. I'll tell you that because okay. I went to the rec early.
Right.
When I first got here, trying to keep up with my workout. And right when I got there, I was caught like with eyes. Like every time I did a workout, some guy would try to come up to me and correct me or like give me a compliment about like my body or something, and that's just freaking uncomfortable. But I agree when you say that everybody's coming together to get in shape. Yeah, but people can't help but judge, and they can't help but be like, I don't know, weird.
But you just said, what's it called, that they give you a compliment, so you don't like compliments?
A compliment is not the right word. It's more like a catcall.
Okay, well, to me, it sounds like a cop. Or, you know, what's wrong with... Wait, you have a problem with corrections.
I'm very stubborn. I don't like people... ask anybody. Ask any of my friends. Ask my ex-boyfriend. Ask the person I'm talking to now. Don't tell me what to do. Just because, even if it's right, I'm not going to do it. Just because you told me to do it. I do what I want.
Okay, so they got worded a little bit different for you.
They got to prove to me that I have to listen to them. If I just met you, why would I listen to you?
You listen to your teacher, right?
Well, they have PhDs. They have certifications. Yeah, I'm going to listen to them. Some of them I don't listen to because some of them are actually dumb. They have no teaching experience, and you could just tell. I think I'm just better than a lot of people. I have a bad mindset.
Okay, yeah.
It's bad. Like I feel like I'm better than everyone in every way.
Oh, Lord. Okay. Oh, Lord. But back to therapy, bro.
Back to therapy. Okay, yes. I got one. Why? I've noticed that men have had a lot of issues going to therapy because they think it's, quote unquote gay. I hate when they say that word. Oh, everything's gay.
You actually heard somebody, you know, a guy say that.
A guy told me that holding an umbrella is gay.
Hey, I don't know about that.
Toxic, fragile masculinity.
See, that's the new generation, man. I ain't proud of that. But anyway, okay. Maybe that could be just because, shit, you know, he's seeing something like, you know what I'm saying? But hey, look, that's the point. But to ask your question though, about like why guys, you know, view therapy in some way, I think it's like it makes us like, man, look weak if we go to a therapist and talk about like our feelings.
I don't
you know what I'm saying? But that's just like the stereotype that I used to have about therapy, you know what I'm saying? And you know, it took some time for me to actually change my mindset and the way I view therapy, and to realize that it's actually pretty good.
It's like the bravest thing you can do is being vulnerable.
Yeah, and the reason I say that is because, you know, there's a documentary that's pretty hot right now. It's called Quiet on Set. You seen that, right?
I haven't seen it, but I've seen clips of it.
Oh, okay. Well, you have HBO?
I don't have HBO. I got TikTok, and I've been watching little clips on TikTok.
Oh, get HBO.
Get HBO, got yes.
you. Well, damn. Okay. But anyway, there's a certain star, Nickelodeon star. I'm not going to spoil it for you.
Just spoiler.
Okay. Drake Bell.
Drake Bell, I think I saw that.
From the Drake and, you know,
Drake and Josh.
Yeah, you know, that's a classic right there.
I've never watched that show.
The disrespect is crazy. But anyway, man, so, you know, he was, you know, he had parents, and he was talking about how one of the producers in the Amanda show, this is before your time. I'm just being honest. All right. And he was there, you know, as like just like a guest regular or whatnot. And he's, you know, one of the producers always have like being near him whenever he's doing something, you know? And at one time, you know, eventually, you know, I don't want to say it, but like basically
it's the reality of it.
Right. But I won't give them the wrong info. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
But basically, he was touched.
Sexually assaulted.
We can do that too. Yes.
Yeah, we can do that.
We can say that too. I was just trying to be a little bit nicer.
That's not. I mean, but you don't have to be nice about it. They didn't want to be nice about it. So here we are.
Fair, yes. So, you know, he was sexually assaulted by one of his producers.
Dan Schneider.
No, not Dan Schneider. No.
So there's multiple.
Yeah. So no. Dan Schneider was not part of the. Wasn't part of the show. But yeah. So one of his producers called Brian Peck. You know, like I said, Josh, you know, Drake was was touched and sexually assaulted, and he never really quite overcame it. You know, it took some time for him to like, you know, talk about it, you know. And I was very I was amazed, because you know, I would have never thought that something like that would happen to him. Because you know, you know what I'm saying. He seems cool. Seems, you know, like I would never thought in a million years that it'd be him. You know what I'm saying. And but when I watched that, it was, you know, him and whatnot, and you know, I just felt bad, you know, because how does someone even talk about that, especially for a guy?
For a guy.
I mean, of course, it's bad for, you know, both girls and guys, but for a guy, it's, you know, it's like it's tough to talk about. And you know, he had my utmost respect, you know, for going be on live camera and talk about his situation, you know. And it definitely made him, you know, give him my respect, man. He had my respect. You know what I'm saying?
Because
that's
something
it's hard to do.
Definitely, especially I can't imagine Because already guys have, like, issues, like, with their masculinity and, like, knowing and telling people that he's been touched by another guy. I can't imagine that, like, how he felt. Well, I mean, look.
Yeah. Well, I mean, of course, you know, eventually, you know, I don't know if he ever really did move on, but he definitely.
You never do. I mean, I can speak from experience. I was sexually assaulted when I was young. And, like, it comes up in things that you don't even think would come up in. Like, it affects you in ways that you don't even think it would until you're in it.
That's true. And that's, again, that's why I created this platform to give people, you know, like yourself and others a safe place to come and share your personal experiences. And or because, you know, your experience, too, you know, can also help a young lady.
Yeah, I hope it does.
You know? What's up, my boy? For those who don't know, man, my boy Joshua Fonto is in the building, man. What's up, yeah? What's up, man? Appreciate you for coming through.
Hello? Hello?
Yeah, there we go.
You can hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, we can hear you, man. We will just talk about therapy, man. Yeah. So what's your take on that?
So, therapy for me, because I got off of breakup, and you know, throughout that breakup, I was always thinking, like, was I wrong? Was I wrong in the situation, or like, was I right? And so, pretty much, I just went to therapy just to, you know, just see and like talk like my feelings as to what I think and see if like I did something wrong or did something right, and it pretty much helped me. You know, I'm going to therapy every Tuesday at 9 o'clock, and you know, I'm having no fluid conversation with my therapist, and you know, every session I come out of, you know, I just feel great and just ready to rock and roll, just start the day.
That's good. Yeah.
Okay. Appreciate you for turning that story. I want that, man. You know, I was just talking to her about even though I don't really go to a therapist or whatnot, I go to the gym, I listen to music, just like that's therapy to me. So like, you know, what's your go to? Like, let's say, you know, if you don't go to, you know, a therapist, do you have an alternative?
Pretty much music. I just listen to music.
Oh, for real?
Yeah, that's all I do.
Okay. So you're in the same boat, man. Who you listen to?
I'm pretty much like old school, so like what's the name? Jill Scott.
You know who that is?
Why would I not?
Okay, I
playing with me.
I'm just saying, I don't know.
Yeah, Jill Scott, D'Angelo, put like a little bit of jazz swing.
Okay. I was just surprised. I ain't gonna lie. I thought you were gonna say, you said old school. I'm thinking, you know, 50, Jay Z, Lil Kanye, you know what I'm saying?
I listen to Lenny Williams. Y'all know who that is? Don't tell me you don't know who Lenny is. Are you kidding?
I mean, look, I'm a little bit old school.
That's the old. That's the old school.
It's before my time.
Is it though?
Who is she?
Lenny Williams.
Oh, my
look
apologies.
That up. If you don't know Lenny Williams, you missing out. Cause I love you. That's that song. Cause I love you.
Okay. I will do.
Great song.
We'll do. But yeah. Oh yeah, my boy, man. Yeah, she was talking about, like, you know, how there's, you know, the stereotype of, you know, us guys going to therapy, and you know, I was just telling her that, you know, it's like we had this assumption or the stereotype that, you know, therapy is like bad, you know, not so bad, but it's just
not bad,
like,
but like emasculine, like,
yeah, emasculine, you know, for us guys specifically, man. I did you think about that at first, you know, before you actually, you know, did it?
The whole masculine thing, I mean, I say, yeah, nowadays it's like over masculine, like it's not respectful in a way. You can be masculine, but you just got to be respectful. So you cannot be, like, talking down on women and, like, be like, you the man, da-da-da-da-da. Nah. It's just, you just got to be real and just be yourself. And that's what's masculinity true masculinity is.
Let's talk about that. What is true masculinity?
Being yourself. That's
damn.
What is true masculinity? What is it?
I honestly
because I don't think y'all know.
I honestly don't know.
So what do you think?
What do I think true masculinity? I think true masculinity could be multiple things. I think it contradicts itself.
I don't.
It contradicts itself. It's being able to be vulnerable and being like a safe hold and a structured person at the same time. Like being vulnerable and still being very strong at the same time. Okay. That's what I think.
Okay.
But y'all get stuck on the strong.
Y'all
get stuck on the strong. y'all hate to be embarrassed. Y'all hate to get y'all feelings hurt.
Hold up, bro. What do you mean?
When y'all get embarrassed, y'all start going crazy. Y'all trying to make up for it. Start doing some crazy stuff.
What you mean by that? Hold on, bro.
Crazy.
That's cap. Crazy.
No, that's not cap.
To a certain degree.
Okay, look. See, there we go. That's all I need.
To a certain degree.
That's all I need.
But, like, I don't think that's kind of fair for you to say, wait, are you saying all of us?
All of y'all.
No.
Okay, yeah. No.
All of
that's
y'all.
Like saying every nigga's bad. No.
Wait, you said bad or mad?
Bad.
That's exactly what I said.
What you mean? So you never had? Okay, you know what?
Everybody got their flaws. Everybody got their flaws. There's no guy.
Exactly.
There's no guy that is really good.
Really?
What you mean by that?
Okay, let me go back to the embarrassed thing. So, yeah. It becomes a safety issue when you guys become embarrassed because y'all start having tantrums. So, for example, I was walking to the courts one day. And there was just two guys sitting by the fence. And I passed him. And he said something to me, but I kept on walking. Mm-hmm. And so then he yelled at me and told me to give him my number. So because I embarrassed him, he retaliated. And I had to give him my number or I didn't know what he would do. Because I embarrassed him because I heard him. I really did hear him. And I like looked at him and I just kept on walking because I was not interested.
Okay.
Yeah. That's just a dude that's just desperate.
But a lot of
guys are.
No, I'm sorry.
A lot of
we're real. We're not gonna do that over here, bro. I'm sorry. The cat that you were right at the first one. You had the first half, yeah. But they ain't not every guy.
Okay, y'all might be might not be desperate for certain things. Y'all might be desperate for something else.
What you mean by that?
Y'all might be desperate for respect, and do anything for it.
No.
Yes.
No.
See, the only thing I'm desperate about is just building myself up and doing what I gotta do just to, you know, be a better person.
I don't say that desperate. I would say that's just
that's a goal.
That's a goal.
Yeah.
I would say yeah. Nah, sorry. I ain't gonna let you do that to yourself, boy. No, I'm sorry, bro. I'm sorry. But nah, yeah. I can't let you slide with that one, bro. No,
you can't.
No, I can't let you slide with that one. You really? Just said every nigga is bad.
Not every nigga.
Yeah.
Okay. Well,
it just. Unfortunately, the ones that y'all meet are.
So where are all the good guys at?
Where you? Yeah.
Where y'all at? Why y'all hiding?
We're not hiding.
Nah,
we're looking really? For y'all too.
Y'all not looking hard enough.
We just end up going with the bad ones first, and then find the good ones later.
Oh, okay.
Respectfully.
Okay. Respectfully.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not. But yeah. But not every nigga that you. Not every nigga is bad. You know. Some there are some guys that are respectful.
Yeah.
Are family orientated like myself.
Mm-hmm.
You know. And know how to approach women.
Yeah, you know? I agree.
So, like, let's say hypothetically, you know what I'm saying? I was in that scenario, right?
Okay.
And, you know, I seen you, right? I would say, hey, excuse me. I don't mean to disturb you, but hey, I got to know what your name is.
That would have been better. That would have been better.
Yeah.
But you also got to be okay with me saying no.
Facts, but hold on. I would say, hey, my name is so-and-so. And I'd be like, hey, what's your name? You tell me, you know what I'm saying? And then... Depending on how far it goes, I'll be like, either ask for your number or your IG. And whichever, you know, if you don't give me the number, I'll be like, okay, no problem. Thank you for your time. I'll let you be.
Okay,
but if
that's
you do give
good.
Me the number, hey, you know that I can move on to step two. You feel me?
Yeah. And what's step two?
Getting to know you.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
You see, it's all about how you approach a woman. And that takes experience and that also takes, you know, time.
Right.
As for us men to mature. Right. You know?
Oh, yes.
Because, like, if you had met me back in 2018, boy. Lord have mercy, boy.
Yeah, the young
I was, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. I wasn't this, you know, I wasn't the person you see now. I was a little, I would say I was childish, didn't really take anything serious, especially the ladies. You know what I'm saying?
Well, yeah.
But over time, as I grew, I started to think this serious. I started to treat y'all, you know, differently, you know? You know, with respect and all that. So again, it's not that every not every nigga that you see is bad. It's just that some are.
It takes
you know what
time.
I'm saying? Yeah. And you know, cause you're gonna meet that, but hopefully you know I'll be done. But yeah.
What I read is that men mature at 35 years old. It was 30 something.
I mean, not all. I won't say.
You don't think all?
No.
They said they emotionally mature at 30 something years old.
I can't believe that.
You can't believe that?
No, I can't believe
that. We read that in science class one day.
And well, not everything is true.
Is science?
You know what I'm saying?
That's interesting. Y'all don't think that. What age do you think men fully mature emotionally to be in a relationship?
When they're ready.
Yeah, that's
also when they're ready.
There's no age that you can say for sure.
No, because everyone's different. Everyone, just like every woman is different.
Yeah, okay.
I can't give up. If I did give you age, that would be not.
Okay, how about for you?
When I turned 21.
What about for you?
About 21.
Okay.
When I turned 21, that's when my thought process of how I view women, what I wanted, and what, you know, and all those other things changed. It just took me, you know,
time.
21. So yeah, it took me time. And when I did figure it out, I knew what I had standards.
Okay, that's
and
good.
And then I broke it down.
That's
then,
good. You know, yeah. That's good.
But going back to what's it called? Therapy, man. I've also noticed that it's also what's it called? You know how you said that your friends, you know, will come in, you know, to your dorm, just to, you know, get you out of bed. Yeah. I've also had that experience too, you know, with my family. I didn't realize that then, but you know what I'm saying?
But having,
you know, family, you know, being with your family also is also like therapy, you know, because you talk to them about your situation, depending on what it is, and you know, you just feel that support. And once you have that support, you can it also levitates you, it also makes you feel better, you know what I'm saying, and it makes you want to do more and be a better person.
Yeah.
Like my boy Joshua said, you know, and I think that's something that us guys, preferably us young black men, or just me and Joe, overlook, because, you know, we think our therapist like, are you okay? Or, you know what I'm saying? Because you don't got to be, you know, going to therapy just, if, you know, if something wrong with you. You just, like, you know, you just might need somebody to, you know, hear you out. Someone to talk to. And sometimes that's all us guys just really need. Just somebody to hear us out. Because once we have a particular bond with someone, it's like, man, they're sharing, you know, our emotion, our pain, they know what we're going through. So we have a sense of, like, trust and, you know, relief. Yeah. So I could talk to you, you know, about certain things, about, you know, whatever it is. And, you know, you always keep it real, you know? And that's something that I think, you know, we need more of. It may not necessarily be of a therapist, but just overall people that we can talk to, you know, both guys and girls, but specifically for us guys, because if we got somebody that we can talk to, a male figure, I personally believe that our perception and our way of thinking will change. Because when we talk to them and we listen, we actually listen, we're going to have a different mindset. I'm like, huh, okay. I never viewed it like that.
Yeah.
No one's ever told me about it this way. I never, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then it changes. We start to change over time. Again, I'm a prime example. As I started to talk to other people that, you know, my male figures that are older than me, I started to see how they talked, how they, engaged, how, you know, to discern things. So what that caused me, it caused me to change the way I view things, the way I acted, the way I discern things. So, like, when something happens, I know how to handle it in a collective manner, you know, in a calm, mature way, you know. But again, it does take time, but eventually it will happen. Have you, you know what I'm saying? Have you been there, you know, like, had to, like, as you engage with people that were older male figures that were older than you, you know, you start to view things differently and see things differently and just sort of change the way you perceive things.
Yeah. Pretty much one example is, like, you and me chopping it up. Like, you older than me, and so, you know, how we just be chopping it up, just talking about just life and how you handle, you know, your relationship with your girl and everything pretty much helped me because, you know, it makes me a better person as to, like, me transitioning to, like, another relationship. And so one thing that's overlooked, it can be older, but it can be your friends, too, because you can have friends, but are your friends going to take a like take accountability? Because your friends can agree with you all you want.
I was just about to say that.
Yeah. They can support you all you want, but that lack of accountability, that's not, I see it as like not real friends. And I would rather, older or not, I would rather have take advice from a person that's like, let's say I have a problem with relationships. I would take advice from a person that been through relationships or like married or something than a person that hasn't.
Right.
Because they gonna make assumptions on things like, oh man, or I don't know how. I don't know. It all depends. But a married one, they gonna keep it real with you 100%. That's all. Yeah.
Sorry. That kind of goes back to what I was saying earlier, how you weren't here for it, but I was saying, like, when my therapist got really aggressive with me and not baby talking me, that's when I would take her serious because she was holding me accountable. Yeah. And when it comes to your friends, you need, sometimes you just need that person that's going to give you that tough love and just tell you straight up, but you have to prepare yourself to not take it personally. And you also, I think you need it like a third party sometimes, somebody that's not even in the mix, that don't know nothing about it, and you tell them straight up how, like, what happened, and get that third party opinion that's not biased, you know.
That's facts.
Like, you know how you said all men, what'd you say, all men was what?
I didn't say nothing.
See, why y'all been doing that, bro? Why y'all been switching up? It's crazy, bro.
I didn't say nothing.
But
you said, oh, man, babe.
My point is,
you said that.
But my point is, like, you know how me and Destiny kind of disagree? Like, like, nah, that's not true. Mm-hmm. And we kind of try to explain, like, we just trying to keep it real with you. Like, oh, man, it's not.
I appreciate it.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Yeah. So I keep it you real.
Sure, there's a good man out here.
Yeah, it does. It's just, girl.
And so, too, you also, like you said, accountability, too. You got also, you know what I'm saying?
What?
Account for your actions, the way you do certain things, and the way you say certain things, too.
Look, don't be sensitive, y'all.
It's not sensitive.
Don't be sensitive.
That's what I'm talking about, man. We have a real conversation, man. You're talking about being sensitive, man. It's not being sensitive, it's just being real with you.
Would you
rather have people be fake with you or be real with you? Which one?
Be real with me. Exactly. I'm real with everybody.
Because I would want you to be real with me, shit. If I discern, you know what I'm saying, that you didn't like, or, you know what I'm saying, I would want you to tell me, hey, so, you know.
I'll tell you.
Yeah, but at the same time, I would have to listen. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
I hear you.
Yeah, it ain't not wrong with taking accountability. That makes you a bad person.
Yes, yeah. It does.
Yeah. Yeah, see, there you go. Nah, I'm saying, man.
I don't know. She might take it. She might be saying yeah, but she might say something.
No, I'm saying yeah. I'll give it to y'all.
Okay.
How about sensitivity?
And that's another thing. You guys don't like to be sensitive. I think that might be an issue, like, going into therapy. They think that's sensitive. You don't think so?
I can see that. I can see that because it will force us to be, like, open up. To someone, and that's kind of like it's hard to do, you know, because I think we have, again, I think I'm talking for me, from my point of view, the way I view it, I feel like it would you know, like I said, it would force us to open up, and, you know, I just had to trust that person and tell them our you know the things that we've gone through, our problems. Mm. Yeah. And so, you know, again, I personally think therapy is really, it's really good. It's really good.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there's a sense of relief once you share your problem. Eventually, you know, over time, as you share your problem, you feel a sense of relief, comfort, and like, man, I actually did it. Now let's work on the next thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Yeah, so you know, therapy definitely. I have the utmost respect for anybody that goes to the gym that wants to go, you know, work on, you know, their body. You know what I'm saying? Because yeah, you know they work it for a certain goal. And for people that do go to therapy, because it takes a lot of courage,
right,
a lot of courage and discipline, I guess, you know what I'm saying, to go talk to someone about their, you know, their problems and whatnot, man.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Absolutely. So yeah, I definitely have respect for people that do that too. And on top of that too, they overcome, you know, the problem or the issue, you know what I'm saying, and they were able to at least on to a certain degree.
Right.
You know? Because again, like I said, depending on what the situation is, it may take longer than others. But if you were able to, you know, get it done, man, you know, it's an amazing feeling, man. It's like doing like creating a project that you eventually finished, and then you move on to the next one.
Right.
You know, that's the way I view, you know, therapy. But again, I never really been through one, mm-hmm, but just based on what I've read and, you know, I've seen, you know, it's an amazing, you know, it can be an amazing thing. And you know, the person that you're talking to will always, you know, keep it hard with you.
Yeah. But you know, I know a friend.
Okay.
His name is God. Like, that's like, I be praying, like, I be like telling God, like, just speak to me. And you know, ever since then, like, he just been like speaking through people. And so I be listening and I be like, okay, everything makes sense. Because before therapy, I just asked God, like, just give me a therapist to, you know, speak through me.
Right.
And pretty much, he really did. And he pretty much told me, like, you did nothing wrong. Like, you okay. You okay.
Yeah.
And other things, like, setting up my journey. Like, he's pointing out my journey and, you know, just...
And another thing too, yeah, turn to the career demand above too. You could be therapy too. You know, again, everybody has their own definition of therapy or, you know, what they think therapy is. But of course, you know, that could also be considered therapy too. You know, that's something that I try to do, you know, at least once in a while, here and there, talk to the career above. Because, you know, once again, if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't, you know, have this opportunity to do this platform and have people like yourself come in and, you know, we talk about these particular, you know, issues, you know, and it's just amazing how God works, you know, because I think, you know, I didn't really think much about this, you know. All I wanted to do was just create a podcast, right? But I didn't want to make it just any podcast, you know,
right?
Because if you think about all the podcasts that, you know, you listen to, they graduated college already, or, you know, mm-hmm, they already, you know what I'm saying, they're in their 40s and 50s right now. And, you know, there's no really a podcast that, you know, that have people our age, that I know of, at least, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, so I wanted to create a podcast. And that's why I call it Next Gen Podcast, because we're, you know, the next generation. Once we get that paper, that degree, we're stepping out into, you know, the world, and it's going to say, you know, who we are, you know what I'm saying? And why not create something while you're here, you know?
Right.
And that's why I created this, to be a safe place, because I wanted also to be a place where everybody's their self, you know. They'll tell me, you know, their story, their, you know, what they got going on, or, you know, let's say, like, if you had a brand, I could, you know, just support you, you know,
right,
like, hey, just, you know, my boy got a brand, and whatever it is, and all
that's
that.
Real.
Yeah, it's got, yeah, yeah. What you think about that, man? Yes, you.
You know, well, I've been quiet because I've been thinking about, like, in my past relationships, like, if you ask a guy what's wrong, they're not gonna tell you.
Mm.
And so then you just have to go off of what you think. And then it's going nowhere. And then at some point, there's like a breaking point where you bring up something and then they come up with like 100,000 things. And it's like, well, during that time I asked you what was wrong and you said nothing was wrong. So where did it come from?
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? So that's just what I've been thinking about, because it, like, what y'all are saying kind of like made that make sense, but it still bothers me that that's even like a thing.
Wait, what bothers you?
Like when we ask you what's wrong, you don't want to say what's wrong, but then when like everything spills out, it's like, I asked you about that during that time and you didn't want to say anything about it. So why is it a problem now?
I think that has to do with maybe they weren't, you know, ready at that particular time. You know, and trust.
It's that lack of confidence, I would say, because I was in the same boat. The person you described, I was that same person. And that was another thing why I went to therapy, just to express myself, because it was hard for me. I wasn't confident as to what I was saying, or I didn't trust what I was saying, because I always thought I was wrong all the time. And so telling you like one day, like when you tell me like what's wrong, I'll be like, I got like 10 different problems, and then later on, like I spill it to you. And so, you know, for me, it like takes time to process everything for me to, you know, fully explain, because I just don't want to ramble all the time. I just want to be real with you. So,
but for girls, it's like we want to hear you ramble.
Yeah, but I think for that to happen, that your significant other or the partner you're with will have to know at least that he can trust you, you know, because you know trust is a very, very it's easy to gain and quick to lose. You know, for us guys, again, I speak for the guys, you know, because I'm not gonna speak on the females, because so for that to happen, like I said, you would have to create a safe place for the guy to feel like, hey, you know, I could talk to her about it. You know, I'm not saying that
I know,
I'm just saying, you know, he would feel that he could be comfortable with you about telling, you know, what he got going on, or what, you know, what he's facing. So when you do that, it's gonna be like, okay, I could tell about this. Now I could tell about this. You know, over time, it's almost like a safe place. You know what I'm saying? Because we're gonna do the same thing for y'all too. Though this is, we're just gonna be like, you know, we're gonna automatically, you know, feel like, hey, whatever your problem is, you're with me. You could talk to me about it when you're ready. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But for us guys, it's gonna just take some time, and you know. Which I know is because shit, it happened to me. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, my girl would ask me the same thing too. But I just think I was just a little bit stubborn to let her know what it was. You know what I'm saying? Because I didn't know if she was going to, you know, use it against me. I don't know if that makes sense. But
it makes sense.
Yeah.
Hello. Okay.
Yeah.
Y'all can hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, okay, man. Yeah, my bad, man. But over time, you know, she created a, you know, a safe place, and you know, saying, we pretty much tell each other, you know, everything, man. You know, again, it just takes that trust and time, man. Yeah, man.
And that's going back earlier when we were talking about our generation. We don't like waiting.
That's true.
Oh, yeah.
We hate waiting. I know I hate waiting. I can't stand it, but we hate waiting, and when we hate waiting, we miss out on a lot of things.
Wow.
And that sounds weird, because you think that, like, you're not missing out on things, but, like, time is, like, our enemy, kind of.
Pretty much, too, yeah. I'm not gonna hold you, man, because, you know, we have this assumption that, you know, we got time, man. We can worry about, all, you know, our health later on, you know, when we reach a certain age, or, you know, this and that. But not really, man. You know, time goes by like that, man.
I remember when I was 16. Now I'm 20.
You know what I'm saying?
Damn. Don't nobody.
Oh, God, man. But it also depends on what you do with that time. You know what I'm saying? Who you surround yourself with.
But then again, it takes time for you to realize.
Yeah, to realize that, too.
Until, like, that's my thing. Like, you're in the moment, but you're not going to learn from it until later sometimes. Yeah. But everything, I believe everything happens for a reason. You just got to, like, be willing.
That is facts. Yeah. That's 100% true.
Yeah, you got to put in that work and just be willing, like, open-minded.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Prime example, man. My boy, man, we met last year, man. And we would always, he's laughing because, you know, he knows what I'm about to say, man. So, like, you know, we'll stay in the, you know, phase one and two, right? You know what I'm saying? And we would see each other, right? You know, the first time, I ain't really nothing about it, you know what I'm saying? It just what it is, you know what I'm saying? I was like, hey, man, you look fresh, man, you know what I'm saying? The same day, I see him again. I'm like, okay, it's cool. But it became like a certain pattern. I'm like, hold up, bro.
You following me?
I was thinking that too. Yeah. But then, you know, I was like, nah, this got to be a reason, bro. You know what I'm saying? And then, you know, we just eventually just chopped it up, man. And, you know, we actually had a lot more in common, man. And, you know, we started to do this, you know, this podcast, you know, and it just, no, I was just like, man, look at God, man. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Like, so yeah, things definitely happen for a reason. So, this, for example, like, you know, you coming on this podcast, man, you know, it could be just to, like, change the way you perceive a certain thing.
Definitely. Or
see, like that, you know, and, you know, all glory goes to, belongs to God. Because, you know, I every time I come here, man, I always do this prayer where, you know, I don't know what to say. I like, hey, God, what you want me to say? Let it be said. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I was given, you know, the glory and honor. You feel me? So, definitely everything happens for a reason, man. You might not know at that particular time.
You're not going to know
but
it until later.
You will eventually find out, man.
And then you're going to think back and be like,
damn.
Like, if I didn't go through that, I don't know what I would be doing right now.
Exactly, man. Exactly.
You're looking up like, Lord, thank you.
You did that on purpose, huh?
Yeah.
It was like, I was so mad when that was happening, but now I get it.
Yeah, indeed, man, indeed. Is there a particular question that you've always, like,
that I've always wanted to ask?
Yeah.
Okay. Wait, give me a second.
No problem.
So, when it comes to, like, relationships.
Okay.
What makes guys want to commit to a relationship?
You want to say that? Should I ask that? You already know what I'm going to say. So I'm going to let you answer yours and then I'm going to answer mine.
So for me, two things. Respect and being yourself.
Okay, but you have to earn respect.
You want me to go in?
Yeah, you know.
You want to tag him in?
Yeah, go.
Tag him in. All
right. So, okay. So, repeat your question again.
What makes guys want to, like, commit relationship, or, like, what makes them not want to commit to the relationship but still want to hang on?
Okay, so I'll answer the first question. What makes us want to commit is the way you can. If you have a certain qualification about yourself, you know what I'm saying?
Like a standard?
Yeah, certain standard. So if you have a certain that you qualify for, you know, for the guy, you know what I'm saying?
That we qualify for. Sounds like a scholarship.
Okay, that sounds bad, but, like, if you know what I'm saying?
If you meet the
criteria, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
We're gonna want to commit with you. Especially, like, hey, you know what I'm saying? My standard was she had to be respectful. She has to just know what she wants. I mean, like, you know, what her goal is. And she has to be family orientated. And most of all, she has to believe the male above. That was that was my standard. And so, you know, my girl fit that. You know what I'm saying? As we got to know each other, I was like, man, she's amazing. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I decided to take her, you know, take her serious. And I started to do things more with her. to see, you know, where this would go. And, you know, it's been an amazing, amazing journey. We had the ups and downs, trust me, on God. You know what I'm saying? Lord. But that's the best part about it, because, you know, it tests you if you are really serious about each other. Because it's easy to, you know, step out of the relationship, man. It's one thing to keep, you know, to, you know what I'm saying? Out. Yeah. Just so, you know, if you have what we're looking for, we're definitely going to commit.
Okay.
Now, the second question is, what don't?
Okay, they don't want to come in, but they still want to mess with you.
I would say that's just looking for a temporary. We're just looking for a temporary satisfaction.
You know what somebody told me?
What?
They said that guys just, that's just how they're wired. Like they might like you. Look, listen.
All right.
They said they might like you, they still gonna mess with other people just because they want to, but they like might still be like they're still in love with you, but they gonna mess with other people just because they can.
I think that's just a certain group of guys.
Certain group of guys.
Yeah, that's a small percentage of guys. Not all guys, but just a certain group of guys, man. You know what I'm saying?
Good to know.
Yeah. I mean, I think that goes with, you know, females as well. You know what I'm saying? But that's just, you know, y'all just a little, you know, a little different. But yeah, it's just a certain group of guys, man.
How y'all feel about loyalty?
Loyalty.
Any relationship.
It's a person for me, so it's a big factor.
Yeah, it's a very big factor.
Because loyalty, man, for us guys, it can make or break it, man. It does, you know what I'm saying? If I find out, you know, if a guy find out, you know, his girl, you know, is doing something that, you know, she shouldn't do, it would definitely damage him. Definitely damage him. So it takes a lot to trust, you know, trust.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And that's what majority of the problems are too, you know, besides communication is trust. So if I trust you and all that, then I find out that you know do something, you know, do something you're not supposed to do, it could definitely change a person, a guy's attitude, the way he perceives things. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And all that. You know, so trust is a very, very important thing in the ship. It should too, if you are looking for a serious, long term one. But if you're just looking for a temporary one, then don't even bother. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. On God, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, loyalty and trust is definitely an important factor in the ship, man. Yeah. What you think about that, man?
Yeah, I totally agree. Especially for a long term relationship, like
yeah,
loyalty is a big factor, but temporary.
Yeah, that's just me. Yeah.
I think loyalty could be in anything.
Mm.
Like, yeah, temporary. I think it could be in, like, it might not be like loyalty for each other, but loyalty in like what we define each other as. You know what I mean?
Okay.
That makes sense.
That makes sense.
So. Explain it in like a friends, like loyalty and friends.
And friends, loyalty and friends is like, I'm always gonna have your back. You're always gonna have mine. I can come to you and talk about anything and get what I need out of it. Like if it hurts, like I know you're loyal to me and loyal to wanting to see me succeed as a person. So.
Yeah. And that's something that's also not as common as much, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, again, we're in a different time now, you know what I'm saying?
People get canceled. No, it's true. Like, you might have something real to say, but people going to be like, oh, don't say that.
Shit, this is my show. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Because that's very interesting.
But, yeah, she's not wrong, though. Yeah,
nobody talks about that.
Yeah.
Talk about what?
Like loyalty, like it can be anything.
Yeah, I think like your freaking dog. I have a loyalty with my dog. Like, yeah, he loyal to me. I'm loyal to him. Like, I'm not gonna pet no other dog behind his back. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Right. Nah. I'm just playing. But yeah, man, loyalty. You know,
like even your teachers, they're loyal to teaching you in the best that they can. Like that's what they're committed in, and they want to see you succeed. Hopefully, they do, but they're loyal to that goal.
Yes, indeed, man. You see, and you did you? Yeah. Oh, I feel like you have a question. Or are you thinking of something?
I think he thinks.
I'm thinking of something.
Think about
because I don't really think that's the finest loyalty. I think it's just respect. The finest respect, because, you know, loyalty is like you committed to that one person only.
Okay, but is it only a person?
It can be an animal or things of that nature.
So it has to be a living thing.
I mean,
I would say you have to be a living thing.
Really?
I would say you have to be a living thing.
Really? Yeah. That's where I disagree.
Okay.
Well, you want to be loyal to a rock?
Like, it's like, when I mean loyal, I think committed, right?
Committed, okay.
So loyal, being loyal to, like, you know. But I think, like, committed, like, you're committed to something, you have, like, a loyalty to it.
Okay.
So
let's look up the definition.
Yeah, let's.
I guess it could get confusing.
Yeah.
But I personally think that if you're being loyal, it would have to be a living thing.
A living thing.
Especially a person.
Hey, what about a plant?
A who?
A plant don't got feelings, but yeah,
it's living.
Yeah, it's a living thing, but.
What did the definition say?
What is loyalty? Okay, so being there for someone through the highs and the lows. Okay.
Okay, someone.
Yeah, so okay. It's a person.
Okay,
yeah.
Bet.
So, yeah, it's definitely got to be a person.
So, what I was... Okay, so loyalty and committed. What's the difference between loyalty and committed?
I'll say the difference between loyalty and committed. Loyalty is mean, you know, you're being loyal to
You can't use the word as a definition.
Okay. Shit. Okay, let me start with the commitment first. What is the difference between loyalty and committed?
See?
You stick it. Whoa, damn, that's where
I was going towards, because they're like one what sometimes, like if. Like, people are committed to seeing you being successful. They're loyal to that idea. That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
It's pretty much along those lines as to what you say, because pretty much the definition of committed is feeling dedicated and loyalty to a cause, activity, or job.
Yeah. So maybe the difference is that loyalty is person-wise, commitment is idea or, like, thing-wise.
Yeah.
Okay, but
yeah.
Okay, look at this learning.
Okay, well, my definition says a strong feeling of support or allegiance for loyalty.
Mm. Yeah.
So, like, that just changed everything.
But it's pretty much in the same belt, just worded in a different way.
So allegiance is loyalty, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, but.
And that's something that we should know. I don't think we have a lot more, especially in this generation, because, you know, I don't say we don't trust each other, but I feel like we don't know who to trust. You don't know. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Especially in this generation, you never know who is watching you, wants you to fail.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or really just, like, you don't know what they are.
Exactly. Like, you don't know if they're for you or against you. What their priorities are and if it aligns with yours.
Right. Yeah. So, like, you know, when I create this type of bonds with, you know, with my boy, Josh, and, you know, DT and the rest of them, man, it's a good thing. It's an amazing thing because, you know, I know for a fact without a shout out that they're always going to keep it real with me. You know what I'm saying? And I could talk to them about anything. You know, America, shit, we're, you know, at the end of the day, you know, we're guys, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, we understand each other, you know what I'm saying? And I think that's something that, you know, y'all, us girls too, you know, should have, you know?
I think it's important to get that other perspective too.
True. Oh, yeah, it's also too getting, like you said, third party, you know what I'm saying? You know, from my side too. Because I'm almost open-minded, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, like, you know, I'm down to hear the guy's side and the girl's side, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know.
Okay, what's some questions y'all got for the girls?
My question is. Nah, you go first, bro. You go first. Because, man, you're going to need a drink for that one.
my question is, say for instance, y'all out of a relationship with a guy, and then y'all assume like that's every guy. So that's my question.
I would assume every guy is like one guy.
Yeah.
It's never, I feel like it's never just one guy that makes, at least me, there's never one guy that makes me assume as a whole. There's multiple guys doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. And then you also hear it from like older women, and that's like, or other college students, they're going to speak from their experience. And most of the time their experience is also negative. So you're going off of what people say, you're going off of what you've experienced, and run with it. It's hard to like revert back to that because so many people have said the same thing, and you've also experienced yourself. So, okay. And like generalizing it makes it easier for us to protect ourselves. Mm. Does that make sense? Like you never want to. Like, my mom tells me this all the time. You never want to start a fight with a guy because you never know what they're going to do.
Mm. Yeah.
And that's...
I can agree on that.
Generalized. Like, they can push you. You can hit your head. You can die. You can get hurt. Anything. So, that's...
Most are wrong, yeah.
It's out of protection, really, because you don't want to get your feelings hurt and you don't want to get hurt physically.
Yeah. Mm. I agree on that. And so, how are y'all, you know, handling it?
The only way to really handle that is to, you know, get some experience with other people. Mm. And that's hard because you don't want to. Yeah. And you automatically assume that, you know, they're like the last person. But you have to just like slow down and just be friends with some guys, you know. Yeah. And just watch how they act, watch how they handle their relationships, and just learn from them and just see what they do. And then you apply that to whatever. Or me personally, I look up to my dad when it comes to, like, guys. Like, if he doesn't do what my dad does, like, if he doesn't act like my dad, then he's not, you know. So you have to have, I have somebody that I have to compare guys to that's, like the most, like, perfect guy, you know, like, the perfect husband, like my dad for me.
Yeah. Okay. I can agree with that, Sunday, because like I view, you know, how my mom treats my dad. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so
you watch that.
Yeah. So I can relate, because I'm doing the same thing. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, because I wouldn't want to just bring any, you know, girl to, you know, meet. No guy really should bring just any girl to, you know, meet their, you know, their parents. You know what I'm saying? Or be with somebody. They got be. Worth it. Yeah. So my question is, do you, how do I say this? My question is, why do y'all have this perception of us guys like we are all, you know, all bad? Like we all just, you know.
Isn't that the same question?
No, but like, well.
Okay, the reason that we have that is just that so many things have happened that there's, like, it's hard to disagree with it. Like, looking at history, looking at the news, there's almost every time I turn the news on back home, some boyfriend killed their girlfriend and her kid. So, like, after, like, y'all, like, at a certain point, after you see that stuff all the time, you hear about it, you're just like, dang, like, how often is this going to happen? And it happens so often, you're like, well, I just got to keep an eye out and just assume you. My mom always says to assume that everybody is a suspect. Everybody's a suspect until you get, everybody's guilty until proven innocent, you know?
Mm, that's true. And another thing is, why can't y'all let certain things go? Like, let's say something.
Okay, I got you. Why can't we let certain things go? We forgive, but we don't forget.
Yeah, I know that. But.
So my boyfriend used to get mad at me for this because I would keep track of, like, the things that he would do and not tell him that I would be watching that. So, like, he would be doing something. Like, he wouldn't open the door for me. I'll keep that in the back of my head. I'll remember that. So I start counting how many times he don't open the door for me. Boom, 5 times. You ain't open the door for me 5 times. So the reason we keep track of stuff is because y'all don't think we keep track of it, and y'all don't think it's a big problem. But when we present it, like, oh, you did this many times, it becomes like a radar, like something like just goes off in your head, and you're like, oh, well, I guess she cares because she keeps track of it.
But what if it happened like a year or 2 years ago? It don't have nothing to do with.
Because look, a cheat, like, okay, let's say, once people show you who they are, you got to believe them. So if they do something, you just have to know that that's them as a person. They could change,
right. But
they have to consistently show that they are wanting to change and are putting effort towards that. We going to remember it just because, again, it's out of safety. We don't want to get our feelings hurt. So we going to remember what you did just in case. We not going to give 100% if you didn't give 100% last year. You have to get back to 100. And until that, we going to remember what you did.
I can't disagree with good. That's facts. Because, good, like, you know, my girl be doing the same thing, bro. I feel like I know, but that's like a.
If you know, then you would have done it.
That's like a year. Again, I'm throwing the from her perspective, bro. I feel like, bro, that's like a year ago. You know what I'm saying?
But that if she still remembers it, that means that it's important to her.
Yeah. That's.
Okay. Remember that. Is she not going to forget? She not going to remember something that is not important to her. If it's important to her, you gonna know because she gonna keep it in mind and go off of that. She gonna, our relationship is now built off of that.
Yeah. I see.
It's important to her.
No, I disagree on that, but I just wanted to know that was
it's that important. Okay. Like the little things matter. Opening doors matters. Right. Like chivalry, that freaking matters. Like where did it go? Where did it win?
Yeah. Mm. That's facts. I'm like, I can't disagree on that, man. Do you think us guys are Germans to a certain degree? Or like,
well, look.
Alright.
You guys get being a gentleman and doing the bare minimum kind of confused.
Okay. What do you think a gentleman is?
So let me start with the bare minimum. Okay. I think the bare minimum is opening the door, closing the door, like, I don't know.
Mm.
Like, that's like, your parents should have raised you to be, like, respectful. That's being respectful, doing the bare minimum. Every guy should do the bare minimum. Being a gentleman is where chivalry comes in, where you, like, you have like a perception of this woman in your head and you just want to like uphold that, and you'll do anything to uphold that. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't want her hands to get dirty, so you're going to do it yourself. You respect her and you love her and you see her like she's so innocent, she's so worth it that I'm going to do this for her. That's where chivalry comes in, and that's where being a gentleman comes in. Like, oh, I don't want you to drive. I'd rather you sit in the passenger seat and enjoy the ride. Let me do the work.
Yeah.
That's being a gentleman. Or let me buy. Well, that, okay, what y'all think about buying dinner on a date? Split the check or?
Simple. Whoever decided to go, hey, say we're going on a date, that's paying.
Okay, I agree. But like as a man, I don't want to see you suffer. I don't want to see you do extra work. So let me do the work for you.
What you mean by that?
Like, I don't want to see you.
You paying the bill?
Hmm?
You paying the bill?
Paying a bill?
Yeah.
Am I paying bills?
You paying the bill for the day.
I'll pay if it's my idea. I'll pay the bill.
Oh, go.
I'm cool with that. Like, when it comes to money, it's not that big of a deal.
Right.
But when it comes to like doing certain things, like, oh, I don't want. Let me give you the umbrella because I don't want you to get wet. Like, that's like, I want to uphold this idea of you, like, that you're so worth it. Let me do this for you.
Yeah.
That's being a gentleman.
Okay.
In my opinion.
Oh, yeah.
Let me show you how worth it you are to me. Like, how important you are to me.
I can agree on that.
Your actions.
I can agree on that. Another thing, too, you know, no one should just, what I was going to say. Another thing, too, you should always watch the person's actions than words. That's mm-hmm. something that I've learned over time.
Yeah.
I feel like you want to talk down.
Go ahead.
Let's talk about that a little bit.
Look, and he got excited when I said guys should be friends with guys. I wanted to see what you was excited about that. Like, we should be friends. Like, just be friends with guys.
Yeah.
What you got to say?
Okay, so, one. What you said again?
What's the actions and words?
Yep. Okay, so, my ex, right? I told her, like, have you, like, found you, you know, and Haley, because she had asthma real bad. And she kept on saying no, like, she be telling me, like, oh, I'm going to find them, you know. And I'd be like, cool. So I'll wait, like, a couple of days, and I'll be like, she'd be, like, coughing. I'm like, did you find your inhaler? She like, no. I'm like, and then again. And so I just got really frustrated, and it just, I'm learning from that. From like listening to like other people, like you saying all this and that, but
are you doing it?
Are you really doing it? Like, I believe it when I see it. You
right.
Know what I'm saying? That's when that quote come in.
Mm.
Yeah, that and applies to everything. Yeah. Every relationship.
Oh yeah, yeah, thanks.
And you said women should be, you know, friends with guys, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, pretty much it's just like just giving them a chance and just. Like you said, like, see their actions,
mm-hmm,
and see what they do,
mm-hmm, in them situations,
yeah,
and keep a tally in your head.
Yeah, so like, I asked for, you know, you'd be like, I mean, you can't agree, you know what I'm saying, but if you kind of interested in the person, say you can like say yeah, cool, and then y'all text, and then just see how it goes. It's not like y'all jumping the gun, because that's another problem. In today's world, like, be so ready to jump.
Yeah, I struggle with that.
Yeah.
I'll be like, ready to go.
Yeah, but you can't do it. You gotta know the person. Because, like, the friends with benefit things, like, that's so idolized. Like,
it's just we weren't talking about that, but I brought it up. I was talking about situationships.
Yeah.
Like, we love situationships. We love friends with benefits. We love, like, hookup culture. Because we don't want to be committed. We don't want to wait to see that. Like the fruit from that.
Yeah.
I say that's I'll sum in one word, a temporary satisfaction.
That was two words.
That's what I meant. Don't judge me. I knew what I was on.
All right, I like what you said though, temporary satisfaction.
Yeah, that's what everyone is. And, I think, we all definitely, so we all been there and done.
Have our urges.
Yeah, but yeah. I feel like that's just like a phase that we over, hopefully it's a phase, but you know, something that we over just over change.
See, like the thing that I think of is like back in the old days,
yeah,
like they just
and what's
got,
old days to you too, you know what I'm saying?
Like it, even like now, like they have arranged marriage, like when arranged marriages were like a big thing, you don't really get to know that guy, you just go in there and you learn to love him. You know, and that's, like, that's another thing. Like, that's why I'd rather commit to a relationship early to learn to love somebody, because I don't think love at first sight is a real thing.
Wow.
You can lust somebody at first sight.
Yeah.
But when it comes to loving at first sight, I don't think that's a real thing. You learn to love somebody. So, and that comes over time, but that also comes with the commitment to do that.
Wow.
But that's why, like, jumping the gun, like, that's why I rush into that so fast, because I'm going to learn to love you, and then I become in love with you, but we're not committed in that relationship, so then it's, like, a waste of my time.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Uh-huh. I totally agree. That's how I say, like, if we're not going to be committed or have a long-term relationship. Like,
what's the point of doing it?
Exactly. And so, like, yeah, that's a fact, because, like, shoot, it's like you're a virgin, right? And you like want to get the experience, and so you just jump
do
that
it,
gun.
Yeah,
yeah. And so after a while, you be like, yeah, cool, like yeah, and then it just starts building up, because once that timer starts,
right,
it's going
to be locked in.
Yeah, y'all locked in, and so it gets exhausting after a while because. Every day.
I ain't got time to play with y'all. I ain't got time. I got things to do. I make time out of my day for y'all, and y'all playing with my time? Heck no.
Yeah.
Heck no.
I'm gonna let that slide.
What you gonna let slide? That's the truth.
It's the truth. I don't know.
I don't like people playing with my time. If you're not committed, if you're not ready to lock in, give me everything you got, and ready for you to receive everything I got.
Well, that's a certain type of person, though. I feel like
that's me.
I can respect that. I can respect that. Yeah, as long as you're being 100.
I'm being 100.
You being 100 right now? Okay.
Saying it's a phase, I kind of do agree because, like, that's what your mind was already set before doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And so after you realize, like, why I'm wasting my time, then maturity-wise, you got to understand, like, I got to focus on myself more than anything. Like, I got to do what I got to do because them late nights coming,
stress.
It's stressful. Because in that moment, you care more about, you was investing more that about that person other than yourself. And so that's another thing. That's the problem is we don't really care for ourselves as much as we care for other people. And it's very draining because we want to do things that we want to do, but yet we want to do things that other people want to do. And so that's just draining itself.
I got another side of that.
Okay.
So me and my boyfriend, we separated after this because he was saying, like, I'm tired of being worried about you because I wouldn't text him all the time. But at the same time, I was just living life. Like, I wasn't doing nothing. I was just enjoying my experience on campus. And that was me putting me first.
Yeah.
And that hurt him.
Yeah.
Did you talk to him or?
Yeah, we talked about it, but I think it just wasn't fair for him to be sitting there worried about me and for me to be, you know, prioritizing my college experience and my life away from home.
Okay.
And my friends here and the life I built here. So it just wasn't fair to either of us. And I think I understand why he was worried because I wouldn't be texting him all the time. I wouldn't be on my phone. I would be hanging out with my friends. But he also should have, I think that was him prioritizing himself, saying, like, this isn't fair to me because he needs to live a life outside of sitting on the phone and waiting for me. So, you know, like, it's okay. There's two ways. Like, sometimes that person is genuinely, like, prioritizing themselves by not, and that might be hurting you, you know?
Yeah.
You got to be okay with that.
Yeah, that's where communication comes in, and that's gonna be another topic for another day, man. I'm not gonna hold y'all, man. It's a wrap for this episode of Next Gen Podcast, man. Y'all have anything to say to the audience?
I have fun being on here. I hope I can come back.
Oh yeah, I'm glad you have a good time, man. I'm glad you know. I definitely need you to come back too.
Really?
I'm not gonna lie to you, bro. She surprised me, man.
I surprised you?
Yes. You surprised me.
I learned a lot.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, I definitely did learn a lot too. I ain't gonna hold you, man. Again, that's why I created this platform, to have moments like these. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Of all, you know, classifications and all that. You know what I'm saying? You never know where, you never know
where them people at.
Yeah. If you could advise if you could give a piece of advice to a young girl that's in your situation, or, you know, go through your situation, what would you say to her?
Do what makes you happy. Like, if it makes you happy, do what makes you happy, but still do what serves the Lord. Like, find that balance.
Okay. And what about you, man?
But for a guy,
yeah. What's the word of a piece of advice of the day, man?
My advice is just to slow down, find your purpose, and find what you really want to do, and invest in that, and go forth and be great. And that's my advice.
Okay. Well, for y'all ladies listening, man, never settle for less, man. Y'all stars. Yeah. It's true, man. It's true.
Love y'all queens.
We definitely do love y'all queens, man.
Aww.
Definitely do. But like I said, man, that's my part of this episode of Next Gen Podcast, man. It's your boy Destiny, and we out.